Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Just remember, Dusty did this. Who did this?
Dusty.
She's amazing. Let's get into this outfit, shall we? I promised I wasn't going to sing like I did at Southern, so I'm not. But just remember, Dusty did this. Okay, let's get into this. I really, and I mean really, really, really love fashion. I mean, I do. Anything that's sparkly or coordinated or blingy or whatever, I have to have it. I mean, I just feel it represents me. I'm looking out in the audience. I saw everybody taking pictures earlier. And I was shopping. I was like, I need those shoes. And like, would it be rude if I was like, you know, just hold the picture. Girl, where did you get those earrings? And ooh, that hair. I'm looking at a pink shirt that I just, talk to me. Okay. Focus. I want to talk about the look. Right? The look. Let's talk about this look. Black dress, blingy shoes, some shimmy. That's my favorite part. I have literally been waiting all day to do that. I'll be doing it for the rest of the day. All right, so there's that. And then there's this bag. Yes, I am an avid Lee press-on wearer. It has a little bling in there. I'm going somewhere with this. Back to the bag. I absolutely, I can't decide if I love bags or shoes more. What is for you? What's your poison? Bags or shoes?
Shoes!
Well, let's talk about the shoes then, shall we? First. So these shoes, and I promise I'm not going to be up here as long as I was for Southern. And let me tell you why. The shoes! These are going to serve as my timer for today. I mean, okay, ladies, let's come on. Only ladies in here so far? Mm-hmm. Okay, so let's just be honest. Do we not time our shoes? Yes? Okay, so we have our shoes where we can walk all day. We can walk a marathon, we can shop up and down the aisles in Walmart, we can do whatever we have to do in those shoes. We know those shoes. These aren't those. There are the shoes where if you're going to a ball, you know you're gonna walk, you're gonna take your pictures, and then you're gonna sit, you know. You might kick them off under the table, you might not. It just depends on the event and the music or whatever. You have your dinner shoes or your date night shoes or your girls night out shoes where you can wear them with my jeans, you can wear them with my dress, whatever. Those shoes. These are not those shoes! But I love them because they're blingy. Right? So they're gonna be the timer for today. Duty will. Now back to the bag. I absolutely love bags. If I had my way, the bigger the bag, the better, right? But some people are like, your bags are too big. So I chose today to be intentional and coordinated. And I wore this itty bitty little bag, which only has my virus in it. You know, the card, the rash, the gum. Yeah, the gum. So I'll just put that in. Let's talk about the bag, ladies, shall we? I promised I wasn't gonna sing, so I'm gonna share this song with you. Just the lyrics. It goes, and you might know it, you might not. It says, bag lady, you're gonna hurt your back dragging all those bags like that. I guess no one ever told you all you must hold on to is you. Is you. Is you. Let's unpack that for a minute. Now, I've said that the bigger the bag, the better, right? But it came to a point where I realized that I was carrying a lot of baggage. And I'm not talking about my actual bag, right? Even in my trunk, one of the things that I do is I host events, I can decorate, I can do all kinds of, I can make anything happen just from my trunk alone, carrying stuff. Somebody felt that one. I could do your hair, I could dress you, I could definitely give you some whatever you needed just from my trunk alone. I'd be able to decorate, get your flowers, let's put those here. Boom. Straight from my trunk. Right? Left one. There you go. I would be able to do everything because I was carrying so much all at one time. Right? I'm going somewhere with this. Okay, I promise. What else is in there? Oh yeah, we're talking about the shoes. You have to have the backups, right? And they're blingy too. That would be in my bag. I mean, everything you could think of. But I didn't realize until recently, very recently, age 38. I was holding on to way too much stuff, right? Is there anybody holding on to anything? No? You got me a little bag, huh? And I had to release or just put down some of that stuff so that I could literally survive. Let's talk about it. One of the other functions that I love about this purse is that it has a chain, right? But I can take these off, and then it's literally just a clutch. How fashionable is that? So that leaves me with this chain. I'm going somewhere with it. I promise. Hang tight. Let me end my surprise. It's my last sort of truth. Alright. I want to take you guys through some emotions. Are you willing to join me?
Yes.
Alright. I'm going to pull some more things from my bag. In no particular order. I'm just gonna reach my hand in there. And remember, Dusty, we were talking about the face, right? Oh, here's a face in the form of an emoji. This one is good. So when I was a kid, music was my escape. I would spend hours and hours and hours on end just practicing a song or, you know, lip syncing to something on the radio and recording it from the radio on a cassette. I'm not gonna tell my age. But music, it was my thing. It was my go-to. It was my escape plan. I had a plan, ladies. I said, one day, if I just keep practicing and practicing and practicing, I'm going to figure out how to get a record deal. And that is going to take me away from all of this stuff that I'm going through. That was the plan. Until the one day when my brother came into my room and said, "You big nose ugly girl, you sound like an old dog." Okay, well, maybe I won't do that one then. But I had a plan. What else do we have? Oh, yeah. This one. Let's put it there. Accessorize, shall we? When I was a little girl, I had a diary. Anyone else have a diary when they were a little girl? Yeah? So who had the ones with the little keys that you put the little key in? It's the cheapest little keyboard. I don't know why they did that. You turn it in and it makes you feel all official. Nobody's ever getting into that, right? My diary was a bit different. In my diary, I didn't want the one with the key until they came out with the electronic one, and I thought it was so cute. It was purple and everything, and I was like, I have to have it. But before that, I just used a diary that I actually had won in a class when I was a little girl. And I would write down all of the things that I was going through, right? Things like what? Okay, well, dear diary, just make it stop. Is there something so wrong with me? Do I deserve this? I guess I do because it's happening. This is me actually writing in the diary. Can you please just make him go away? What am I gonna do to make him go away? Dear diary, well, I got beat up at school again. They said don't hit your friends, but I guess they're not my friend because they hit me and I was told not to hit back. But at least that's over. I wish I didn't have to go over there after school. I wish he didn't do all those things to me. I don't. Who am I gonna tell? Who's gonna listen to me? I'm just a kid. I'm nobody. I wrote all those things in my diary and much, much more. I'm gonna leave that right there because I'm going somewhere with this. What else we got? Okay. Who knows this face? I definitely wore that. I was a mad child. You ever ask somebody to say, what's wrong with you? I'm mad. Right? I was angry. I was angry with everybody all the time. What's wrong with you, Alicia?
Nothing.
Anybody ever say, ask you what's wrong, you're just like, nothing. Just hold it in and just be the warrior that you are and just go on about your business. How about doing that as a kid, right? That was me, story of my life. Oh, if I say, oh. I'll tell you what. I felt love from my mommy, my aunts, who were a huge support system. Love them all. But my heart, over time, it grew so cold. I love a boy. Ew. Even when I grew up, I had zero respect for men. I would not let love in. You want to be my friend? No, I don't need you. Find somebody else. I would become so cold, so distant, to where it was like my family members didn't even know who I was. And on the inside, I'm like, ask me what's wrong, and mean it. But, I mean, of course I couldn't tell anyone because they won't believe you anyway, right? Just write it in your diary, leave that diary out. Maybe somebody will just pick it up. Because I didn't use the key, right? I just left it open. I'm gonna put it right here. Mom is definitely coming in here. She's gonna bring me my clothes and all that. Put it in here. She's gonna put it right there. So I know she's gonna look there, right? And she's gonna see all of this stuff that I put in this diamond, and she's gonna help me. Stay tuned. There's Emoji City. So this one. I don't want to exist anymore. I don't want to live. At a very, very young age, probably in the same place where I put that diary for Mama to read, I went into the laundry room. I got some bleach. Has anybody ever heard the expression, drink bleach? Nobody's ever heard that? Yeah? Okay. Okay, this is a kid, right? That's it. That's my ticket out of here. Because Chris is my brother. Chris already told me that I'm not gonna get this record deal. And I sound like a dog, so okay, that's the plan. Somebody wants me here anyway. Otherwise, I wouldn't be going for this. I'm gonna drink bleach. I went into the laundry room. I got the jug of bleach that did not have the child protection cap. I just want to point that out. I got that, right? I remember sitting on my floor in my room. It had to be a Friday night because I was watching TGIF. If nobody knows what TGIF is, we need to have a whole different conversation. But one of my shows had just gone on TGIF. And of course, you know, I had to keep up with all those shows because I had this other plan where, okay, I'm gonna watch all the shows. And, you know, in my head, these were my family members. This was my ideal family. You know, it had the nice cousins and the nice mom and the dad who was, you know, just amazing at everything. He could fix stuff, he could do all the things, and there would be something motivational in it. And so this was like the perfect thing. I was going to figure out how to run away so that I could, it was quite elaborate, but whatever. I was a kid. It was a plan, right? And so I was like, well, I guess I'm gonna be doing that, so I'm gonna drink this bleach. But I never will forget sitting on my floor, took the lid off the blue cap. I poured some on the top. And I smelled and I was like, oh, this is horrible smelling. I don't know about this one. No, I'm gonna do this. I'm done with this. And then I thought about my younger cousin. She had to be about 1 year old. 1 year old. 1 year old. And I thought about, okay, girl, if you do this, who's gonna protect her? Who's gonna, okay, you can't do this. You gotta do something else. You gotta live, girl. And so in that moment, I chose to live. Not for myself, but for others. You know, if I leave, this is gonna make mom more sad. And then nobody's ever gonna tell the story. And for now, I have to take care of her. I have to protect her. The kid protecting the kid. That's just cool for my bag, right? Let's do that. Let's go on. What else we got? Oh, yeah. Has anybody ever felt this emoji? This was me. For as long as I can remember, up until I was a very mature, but still young and sassy adult. I say young and sassy adult. Even though I'd be wearing the blinged out shoes and the dangly earrings, and I'm working and I'm doing all the things and I'm volunteering in the community and I'm doing all of the things that I'm supposed to do. On the inside, that's my face. Has anybody ever just put on a strong face just to keep moving on? Just keep it moving. Business as usual. I'm okay. I wore that face all of my life, since I can even remember. So I'm gonna put that right there. Oh yeah, I was just talking about that, right? You know the face that you're really feeling. But I'm okay. I got this. You're amazing. You go and be great. A-okay over here. But on the inside, I literally wanted to just die. I told you I was mad, right? I was an angry little kid. I would fight anything with shoes on. Anything. I don't care. Hey, you're so pretty today. I will hit you in your face. Tell you about my dad. Get away from me. I was a fight kid. But the truth is, I never really bothered anybody. I would keep to myself, I would do my homework, I was a straight A student. I did all of the things, but yet things would still happen to me. And you keep thinking, she keeps saying, things keep happening to me. Let's keep pulling from this bag all of the things that we're carrying. Fear. I was told, from what I can remember, I was maybe 9-ish, probably. I remember being told, after I continued to endure molestation, sexual abuse, I had got the courage, because I'm the big bad girl. Like, you know what? This ends today. I'm gonna tell my mom what you did to me, grandpa. Granddaddy, as we call them in the Delta. I'm gonna tell my mom, and all this is gonna be over. I'm gonna protect my family, and I won't have to deal with you ever again. Who's gonna believe you? You're nothing but a little girl. Do you know who I am in this community? Do you know who I am in this family? You're gonna shut your mouth and you're gonna lay right here and you are going to do as you are told. That was my life as a kid. Go on, there's more. Oh, here we go. Shh. Don't you tell a soul. Don't you tell anyone. Because if you do, I'm gonna make sure your mother's lights get cut off. I'm gonna make sure that everybody knows that you're a nasty little girl. Nobody's ever gonna love you. You're nothing. You're nobody. Shh. Don't tell. But before then, one of the things that I remember one of the very first encounters. just in retrospect, I'm thinking, I remember hearing, hey, I had to be maybe two, I don't know. What age are you when you start remembering stuff? Who knows? All right, I remember, hey Sal, one of my dogs' nicknames, we've been a Delta, we haven't been stopped. Hey, you wanna play a game? Yes, I wanna play a game! I guess I could talk, so apparently I was at least two, three. So y'all helping me put some things together? Look at you, go you! You wanna play a game? Of course I do, Big Daddy. Okay, all you have to do is sit up here, and when I move my belly like this, what? You'll hear the ocean. Put your hand right here, and you'll hear the ocean. I can hear the ocean in there? And if you do it really well, a whale just like, what? But as a little kid, who wouldn't be excited about hearing a whale? There's a whale in your tummy? Right? More tears. All I could do was cry to myself. Does that always match my, no, not really. All I could do was cry to myself. Pray my mama's lights wouldn't get cut off if I decided to tell. Pray someone would listen to what I'm really trying to tell you. Hello? Something is wrong. I'm not acting the same way. When I'm in the same room, I get distant, I get quiet. But all I can do is cry to myself, just no matter what my face looks like. And I like to think I have pretty cute faces. I'm great, I'm good, I'm wonderful. But in the inside, I literally wanted even growing older, I would celebrate others. I'd come to all the events. Oh my God, good job. I'm so excited for you, last party. But even growing into a woman, I still felt distant. I still felt on the inside, no matter, you know, I got my dancing shoes on, let's party. But when party was over, I still felt like nothing, no matter how it looked on the outside. Oh, this one right here. This, to me, this one says it all. It says, no matter what's going on, it's gonna put on these shades, it's gonna block it all out. That's called denial. Yeah, it's fine. You know, just put on this armor. Nobody will know a thing. Just keep going, keep being great, keep showing up for everybody. It's fine. We're almost out, y'all. That's a doctor. Doctor emoji. They got all kinds. Let's talk about when I was maybe junior high. And let me be clear. All of these dates and times, they're question marks, you know, because when you experience trauma, the first thing your body wants to do is defend you from it. It blocks you from all of the things. So, yes, some of the events are a little hazy, or some of the dates and times and ages are very much hazy. But I do remember that one day Mom took me to the doctor. And I, so she took me to the doctor, and the lady checked me out, and she's probing and all those things, which were new to me from a doctor anyway. She came back, the nurse said, I will never forget. She said, you need to tell me right now. I'm gonna give you some paper, and I'm gonna tell your mom to walk out of the room, and you need to write down the name, or tell me the name of whoever the little boy was that you were with, because he gave you a disease. And that means you won't ever have kids. You'll be what's called sterile. The decisions I had to make that day. I had to decide that day, God, am I gonna break my mama's heart? Because we all know I'm gonna protect my mom at all costs. I'm gonna protect her feelings. I'm gonna make sure that she doesn't have to cry. Because I love my mama and I do anything for her. I don't love myself, but I love my mama. And I'm gonna endure whatever it is that I have to endure so that I can make sure that my mama doesn't have to cry and go through all of the things, because it's gonna tear our family apart. It's gonna. So I made up a name. I just made up the first thing I could think. His name is Light Switch. That was funny. And I spent, just because I knew I would, first of all, I was nobody. I was useless. I knew that anybody who actually falls in love with me, and I'm not gonna let that happen. I mean, you can love me if you want to, but I'm not gonna love you to act. That's just a fact. I was told as a young girl that, okay, let me tell you this. One day, my grandfather, and I'm saying it like that because I could never even for years say his actual, I couldn't refer to him as my grandfather. I would say my mother's father or my grandmother's husband. Isn't that something? Let's put that there, Doc. I'm running out of space and I'm running out of time. But I would never, ever, ever be able to forget how these things would affect me. So I said, okay, I'm gonna be sterile, I can't have kids. Okay, so you know what? I'm gonna bury myself in those books. I'm gonna be a career-driven woman. I'm gonna let no man get close to my heart. Take me on dates, whatever, but I'm not falling in love. And then love happened. And I will never forget the day that I went to my then soon-to-be mother-in-law's house, and the first thing she said once my husband left the room, I think she was like, Tootie, go give me a bag of eyes. That's my little Jeremy. That's his nickname, Tootie. Oh yeah, that's out there. Anyway, Tootie, go give me a bag of eyes. And then she nicknamed me Big Doll. Now, baby doll.
Oh, here
you
go. Yeah.
Now, you know that's my only son. And I'm going to want some grandbabies. I'm saying, Lord, let me get my stuff here. I'm not the one. But love happened. And I still have all this. But it was something about that man. That's another story for another day. But I got all the way up literally to the altar, still deciding if I'm going to go through it and just let love be. And I'm like, I can't do this. I can't have children. The doctor told me so in 1998. So that tells you once somebody gets into your head, that's it. Once someone has control over your mind, they control you. Do you believe that? I did marry him. I did allow him to let, what a coincidence. I did decide to let love in. I did decide to put some of those bags down because I was tired. I was tired of putting on the facade. I was tired of looking the part but feeling as if I am falling apart daily. Y'all, I was tired. And the truth is, you will never, ever change a thing until you get tired. Am I right? So, what did I do about it? I'm gonna tell you, we have two more things to do. I'm gonna give you some statistics. Make it official. I'm gonna give you some statistics, right? Some facts. And then I'm gonna tell you what I did and what I'm doing. And then I'm gonna tell you what you can do. Y'all ready for that? Let's do it, ladies. All right, here we go. Move the cord. See, I'm clearing the baggage already. All right. Fact. So I put a clip on this so I could pin it on me too. I was like, maybe that's not a good idea. All right, so when we were at Southern, I asked everyone to do something. So I'm gonna ask you to do the same thing. All right? First, think about why JA? Why did you sign up for this? Why did you decide to join? You want to help the kids? Yes. I said, say yes?
Yes.
Okay. Now let's try this. Y'all did not do good. Okay. Why did, do you want to help the kids?
Yes.
All right. Let's do it. I'm going to give you some statistics, and I just want you to think about your day. Think about your work day. Think about your life. Think about everything that makes you you. Everything that you're doing for yourself, everything that you're doing for your community. And then I want you to think of one name. I want you to think of one child, just one. It can be your child, it can be your niece, your nephew, cute little kid from Sunday school, it can be any of the thousands of children that we serve. Just pick one child's name. Place them in your head. Okay? You got it? You need a circle. And I'm going to share some facts with you. Okay? Not a lot of them. Fact. About 1 in 10 children will be sexually abused before their 18th birthday. This year, there will be about 400,000 babies born in the U.S. that will become victims of sexual abuse unless we do something to stop it. Fact, about 1 in 7 girls and 1 in 25 boys will be sexually abused before they become 18. Fact. The primary reason that the public is not fully aware of the magnitude of the problem as in sexual abuse is because only about 38% of child victims disclose the fact that they have been sexually abused. And some never disclose. Do you still have that one child? Just one child. These were facts. But the biggest fact is that each and every one of us can do something about it. Maybe some of us are holding on to some things ourselves. Ladies, I was holding on to a lot. A lot. But one day, I decided to put some of those bags down. I decided to not be a victim, but be victorious. To be the phenomenal woman that I know I am. So let's get rid of some of this stuff, shall we? And I'm gonna share with you a few things. Oh, what do you know? It's my book! That was horrible. I'll work on that next time. One of the things that I did was I wrote a book. Now, I wrote this book. It only took a little while because it's not long at all. Okay? You could literally read this on your way home and be done. But there's a reason for that. I wrote this book. And I actually completed it on the day of my grandmother's birthday, my late grandmother's birthday, which was back in March. And I said, whew, wait a minute. I'm not going to release this. You know what? No. How is it going to make the family look? Oh, your business is going to be out in the street. But I thought about that one child. As a matter of fact, I thought about three. My son Tyler, who's 7. My son Carter, my rainbow baby. He's 5. He's in kindergarten, y'all. And then I thought about my daughter, Ivy. She's 2 now. I thought about leaving this world. And I, of course, by now I had put all these suicidal thoughts way behind me because I had so much to live for. I allowed love to come in, and I had a man who I loved and I knew loved me for all of the right reasons. I had my beautiful family, but then I thought about the generational curse. I was so tired. It was weighing me down. I had to let it go. I said, I won't walk another step in my pretty little shoes, wearing any amount of shimmer, having faith be to the gods, as they say. I heard they say that. I'm trying to be cool. Whatever. All that means I'm not cool. Okay. I said I won't walk another step with this on me. I had so many opportunities throughout my whole life. And speaking of that diary that I wrote and left open and all that to get help, you want to know what happened? I gravitate toward this pink, so yes, I'm looking at you. I came home one day and those pages were ripped out of the diary. And that was when I was a kid. So this book is all the things that I can remember in no particular order, and I said that in the book. But I said, this stops now. I am not promised tomorrow. I need my children to know that it's okay to speak up. You still thinking of that child? I need my colleague who has a bit of a chip on her shoulder, who's wearing her emotions on her sleeves, but she doesn't realize it, or she doesn't realize that anybody realizes it. Oh, she's mad. Don't talk to Becky. They don't realize that there's so much that we're holding on to. They don't realize there's so many things that we've gone through. They don't realize that we are just barely holding on. I will not walk another step because I am not promised tomorrow. If I left this world today, I need my children to know that they are loved, they are valued. It is okay to say what's on your mind, because I'm from the Delta. You said, yes sir, no sir, yes ma'am, no ma'am, you did as you were told, you do not look them in the eye. What a bummer. But it is okay. You can talk to me. You can say how you feel, and I will actually listen. I won't push your feelings to the side and say, honey, we'll talk later. Go get your tablet. That will never happen. I wrote this book, and I started at a very young age educating my child, my children, of how to communicate. Hey, tell me exactly how you feel. It's okay. I wrote the book. I wrote the book, and I, of course, this was the very first time, age 38, 38 years of carrying all of this. I had to let it go, right? So this book, in addition to communicating with my family members and telling them that I love them every single day, taking 1,000 pictures, holding my babies tight while they let me, because they're growing so fast, and serving as an advocate for effective change, for positive change. That's what I'm doing. This book has my story, things that I can remember, some of the things that were ripped straight from my diary. It has an educational poem, because I want you to be able to explain it to a little child, and if you're an adult and you're reading it for yourself or for that kid that's in your head or in your heart or in your home or you can relate to it. Explaining what sexual abuse is, what molestation is, what good touch is, what bad touch is. Someone might say, this is a game, this will be fun, I'm just tickling you. Just lay down, you know you want it. These are some of the things that I've actually heard. I put them right here in the book. I am literally an open book. There's an educational poem, my story, and then I added a workbook so that you can write down how you feel. If you're communicating with your family, you can break it down. If you're working on yourself, you can write it down. You can bring that darkness to light when you're ready. And you don't have to feel like you're alone. And then, I did one more thing. I added affirmations to the back. Let's use one of these clips, shall we? It's not love. I will speak my truth. Get off me. I went for dramatic effect. That's what I said. I will be heard. I am free from hate. I'm letting it go. I forgive myself. I forgive others. I will not be bound by shame, by all the things that hurt me. I'm much bigger than that. I'm ready to love. I'm ready to celebrate life and everyone in it, because we have but one. I'm letting some of that baggage go. I feel so much lighter, y'all. I'm hot. I can do anything. The sky is not the limit. There's galaxies. I am love. I am love. I will love. Let's see what else we got. This is from the actual book. I dismiss all negativity. I am unapologetically me. And I will walk in my purpose. That's something that we can all do. That's something that you're doing right now. All of the meetings that you attend, y'all, this is a mess, so I need to take it off right yet. Let's do that. All of the things that you're doing for the community, that one child that you have in your head, or several children that you have in your head and in your heart, how do you help them? Listen. Listen to what they're saying. Allowing communication, showing up like you do every day, even when you're tired. No matter what region you're from, you can make a difference. And you're doing just that. You've heard the numbers. Hundreds of thousands of lives we're touching, we're changing. And just realize that you are enough. You are everything that you are supposed to be. And the sky is not limit. Communicate. Sometimes we're not ready to speak our truth. Be patient. Yeah? Be patient with yourself. Don't beat yourself up. You're wonderful. No matter who says otherwise. You are making a difference. Sometimes that one pen pal might be the only motivation that some of these our children are going to get. That one bus that you feel, some of the things are going to go to some children who are absolutely miserable and don't love themselves. That smile that you're bringing. Everybody say cheese. No, I'm so hard. Yeah, we did. That smile can literally light up somebody's life. When I was a kid, I had women just like you. You know, I was so grateful for my aunts and everyone who loved on me, and I needed that, just like our children need you. So that's what you can do. That's how you can make a difference, because you're warriors. Aren't we, ladies?
Yes.
I said, aren't we, ladies?
Yes.
Yes, we are. And I'm A.T. Merritt.